Hello and welcome to the non-Greg Strillis, Greg Strillis show, except only the substitutes. I am your host, the Pamazon.
And Johnny number five.
I'm in black and white for some reason.
But you like that old-timey look.
Yes, you're an old-timey person, so you get an old-timey camera.
Sepia, but black and white will do. But we've got a tiny little buddy here.
A tiny wow.
Look how cute he is. He's just a baby.
He's just a 4 or 5 year old baby.
No, he's just a baby.
And you got me.
Oh, duds.
To star, yeah.
Duds.
The duck with luck who can, you know.
We saw a lot of exciting duck varieties at the fair.
There was ducks, yes, that's true, in the agricultural building.
Yeah, there was all sorts of weird ducks. There was this one that was called the German spotted bill duck or something. I thought it was a section of chickens, but it was just a section of really weird small ducks.
I like the bunny section.
Bunnies are delightful. I liked all the animals, really. But
yes, and John did not know how affectionate cows can be, so I was showing him if you scratch them, I was scratching the side of his little cow face, and he was like, with his eyes closed, and then he licked John.
Well, the thing is, I saw it licking me, and that was going to be fine. I thought it was going to be soft, like a dog tongue. But, you know, I saw the tongue coming out, but then it wasn't soft at all like a dog tongue. It was like a gigantic cat tongue. And that kind of freaked me out, because if I would have known, that would have been one thing. I was like, oh, it's going to lick me, how cute. But then it was just very harsh.
And then you screamed.
Because I wasn't expecting it to be so harsh.
And you scared the poor
John
cow.
John tends to scream a lot.
I do. I do scream a lot.
He scared the poor cow, and he, like, jumped and pulled away. And
I felt really bad, but, like, I didn't know they had scratchy tongues. That was a little surprising.
It was, like, kind of getting jealous, because I was scratching the one, and it was like, hey, what about me, man? You can scratch me. And then John starts to scratch it. Like, so many screams at it.
I mean, I felt bad, but I didn't know.
Well, the other one was very shy, and it was upset we were scratching the other two and started, like, you know, bellowing and screaming and making crazy cow sounds in protest that it wasn't getting scratched, but it was also, like, really crazy, and we couldn't scratch it, so.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, I don't know. That is fascinating. It's interesting how... I don't know. I love... Cow culture is in, like, some societies, but not others. I just find that fascinating.
Like, what do you mean by cow culture?
Just, like, the use of cows as, like, some sort of, like, farm animal. You know, you see it a lot in Asia. You see it a lot in Europe. You don't really see it a lot in Africa or, obviously, the Americas pre-Columbia. Now you do, of course, but I don't know. I just think it's interesting that, like, in, like, it is in India, but, of course, it's different in India because...
Aren't they sacred?
Yeah, because they view them as, like, more of a sacred animal. Yeah. But they still use them for, like, cheese and stuff. I don't know. I just think it's fascinating how, like, you know, it's such a big part of, like, Middle Eastern cultures and Japanese culture. And it is in Chinese culture, but they don't really, you know, they're not really dairy-based like it is in other places. It's fascinating. I don't know. I just think it's interesting how it's so prevalent in different ways in different cultures. And how, like, I feel like we sort of have the mix of, like, the beef culture as well as, like, cheese culture because of so much of the British and the German influence as opposed to other parts of Europe where that's... Well, Europe, I guess it's really pretty much always the case. A lot of Europe and a lot of Asia, but I don't know. I guess it's just if it was other people, it wouldn't necessarily be so as much. That's not really any kind of interesting point. It's just something I was thinking of.
Okay. All right. I was desperately looking for a segue.
No, I don't know. I just think it's interesting how farm animals are different depending on the culture, but they're also really similar in cultures you would not necessarily think it was so similar in. Like, you know, I just find it interesting that Japanese cattle culture is so similar, even in, like, medieval times, to, like, the cow culture of, like, you know, Western Europe.
Oh, Pep's kind of hot. He's panting.
Yeah, Chippy gets hot. Our theory is that he's from the mountainy, snowy area of Chihuahua, Mexico.
Yeah.
Because Chihuahua, Mexico is also a very interesting place. And there's parts where it's like deep forests and even lush jungle is. But there's also parts that are just complete deserts that basically look like the Sahara. And then there's also huge mountainous areas with like lakes and huge snowy mountains and places where it basically stays like really cold all year. And Chihuahuas are from all sorts of different areas of Chihuahua, Mexico. Our theory is that that's... Well, that's the
often
thing.
Well, he also
thing.
Walks around in the snow with no problem, too.
He does. You know, I think... My guess is that some of the short-haired Chihuahuas are from that, but also probably the long hairs are even more so from that area.
But yeah.
I like long-haired Chihuahuas.
So did you... I know what else we can say, because we went to the Hemlock Fair. It's the little county fair in Livingston County. And we got to do some exciting stuff. We got to judge the jams. And by
honey.
Jams, we mean a jam you put on your bread. Not this kind of jam.
not the printer jam.
Not the printer jams. No, not the printer jams. Yeah.
The jellies.
The jellies.
The jellies. Not the Bob Marleys.
Not the Bob Marleys.
The only one that was... I didn't think it was that good was the one that she straight up said was made with Kool-Aid. Why would you make your jam with Kool-Aid?
I think she said it was made with juice, not Kool-Aid.
I thought she said it was cherry Kool-Aid, pomegranate. No, it wasn't pomegranate juice because she said there wasn't even any pomegranate in it. And I thought she said there was juice too. Maybe I was wrong.
Oh, I could be wrong.
I thought she said it was both.
Well, there were three kinds. There was like a champagne. There was a mimosa one that was like champagne and orange.
I really liked that one a lot.
We were really thinking about it. Of course they cook it, so there's no alcohol in it. But our little nephew took a taste.
It still tasted like there was, though.
Yeah, it did. And he was just like horrified. Yeah, but, you know, you cook it. You have to cook it, so you cook out all the alcohol, yeah. And then there was a blueberry peach one, which I could not taste because I'm allergic to peaches, so that kind of sucked. I'm like...
That's too bad. I think that was the best one.
Straight up blueberry. Why do you gotta go with?
Why you gotta put some...
Why do you gotta be combining the fruits? You know?
Exactly.
And for all that, it didn't even taste like peach at all. I never would have guessed. And the other people said the same thing. You'd never even know it was peach
and
in it.
Yeah, that's the one that won, which I think shouldn't have because... You could not taste the peach.
I mean, it tasted the best, though, but you couldn't taste the peach.
Okay.
It definitely... I don't know if it was just because it combined with the blueberry to give it this, like, extreme blueberry taste, but the taste of blueberry was so extreme and so...
You don't like blueberries that much, though, do you?
Oh, I like blueberries.
Okay.
It just gave it, like, a very, very pungent blueberry taste. So I don't know if maybe the peach just enhanced it and that's what it was, but it just tasted like super blueberries.
And then we got to do the honeys, and there was spring honey and fall honey.
They were both really good.
They were both very good. It's true. The spring honey was... I never actually had spring honey, so it was pretty... It was more sugary, for sure.
Yeah, I liked... I used to go to the different bee... I don't know what you call them, like bee, hive...
Apiary? What you call it?
I don't know. Something like that. But there's all sorts of ones in like...
The hivery.
Thousand Islands where they have different people with the bees. Like, they just sell them. And I used to get it every time. And I just like different kinds of honey. It's really fascinating. I wish we could get some bees to our strawberries. That's whatever my dad swears is what you need.
Well, they look kind of dead, which is making me not too amused. Damn it all.
I mean, yeah. It's too bad you're allergic to bees. It'd be cool if we had our own, like, beehive. But.
Maybe. I don't know, man. I don't know about that. I mean, we had beehives on... Somebody kept bees on our property, and they would pay us in sweet, sweet honey.
Yeah.
And boy, let me tell you, if you have real honey, you taste that... Stuff in the grocery store is nasty. A lot of it's fake.
Brownish yellow sugar.
Yeah.
Yep.
Just sugar.
A lot of it is fake.
It is. I often. It's like that with. I don't like non-oil separated peanut butter for the same reason. I think it's so gross now, eating the regular peanut butter. I just don't like it.
So another fun thing we did is. So, where my family lives is near Latour State Park in Stony Brook. And in between, there's something called Saunier State Forest. So we're like, we're going to get to the Saunier State Forest. Now, Saunier isn't... It's this place that... It used to be the Craig Colony for epileptics, and then they also had, like, developmentally disabled people there. And so there's all these buildings. They're all abandoned now, but it was, like, a very... In reading about it, and even the Museum of Disability History said that it was very, very humane. And they had farms and places for people to work. But they had this... They had epileptic people there because they believed that the other epileptics could sense when they were going to have a seizure and help them. That wasn't really proven to be true. So there's all these buildings there in Saunier. And, you know, when we were kids, everybody was very, like, they didn't really talk too nicely about it. And, you know, it was like this place of mystery. And... we would drive by it, but we put into Google, how do we get to the Saunier State Forest? And we drive in, and it takes us up through the whole abandoned buildings that were this colony, and they had farms, and they had Catholic, Protestant, and Jewish churches, and all these really cool buildings. They were all abandoned. It was kind of sad. And so it kept saying Saunier State Forest this way. And then we get to this spot and it says Saunier State Forest this way. And then across from that sign says, you know, correctional facility. Because
some of
now
them were on the same
jail.
Stake. It was on the same metal stake.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a huge jail there. And we're just like, and it says, do not enter, you will be prosecuted. And we're just like...
But they were on the same metal stick that
I know.
Said State Park, but then also said do not enter. Metal,
I know,
whatever.
We're like,
police
what do we do? This is so crazy. And I saw another road. I'm like, so let's try the other road in the other part of the Craig Colony. And we pulled up to that one, again, on either side, said the same thing. We're like, maybe we missed something. So we went back to the original. We realized at the front of it, it said, you know, do not enter. So we were trespassing, but...
But then why are all these signs that even as you're driving along through where you're trespassing, it says, stay back this way, come on through.
It was...
You're not supposed to go through, but, like, the signs yeah. say you can go through.
Say to go through.
And the only way in is this really weird way. It's on a giant back road with a bunch of, like, farms, and it's just, a gravel path.
With a big strip of grass in the middle of it. Yeah.
That's the only way in. You'd never even know it was there. There was actually no signs there saying the park was that way.
I mean, was so crazy to see all those beautiful buildings abandoned, though, and just this ugly-ass prison at the top of the hill. I'm like, why didn't you do something with this? And then when we were getting, we kind of just gave up, and we looked at the map, and we drove up, and we found the road. But on the way, there was a huge cemetery for the institution, and it had, according to this, it has 2,000 graves in it, which is crazy. But another thing I found out in reading about it, which is also nuts, is that many places didn't bother to put markers or anything and just buried mass graves. So this place, people had markers, their names were on it and stuff. But it was bizarre to see this gigantic cemetery behind it, you know, because it's so huge. You know, and trying to go around to get to the state forest, we went around to the back of this huge abandoned institutional facility. So it was pretty wild. I'm surprised that they haven't had any, like, ghost adventure people, although, unlike some other institutions... Oh, shit. Yeah. I guess this one was very humane and had different, you know, things
so
like...
So there's no ghosts there.
So probably there's not going to be as many because people didn't... They were treated more respectfully, according to the Museum of Disability History. But it was pretty wild to see it. It was definitely interesting. So then, yeah, when we got in the Sanye State Forest, you drive, I mean, literally the dirt road has a huge thing of grass in the middle. And then you're like, is this illegal? Am I doing another illegal thing today? Not just driving on the prison property and tooting around. And, yeah. But that was not illegal, but the Sanye State Forest is a very much a... It isn't like Letchworth or Stony Brook where there's paths and things are marked and stuff. It's like, here's a forest, motherfucker.
Yeah, it's really just a forest.
Yeah. Good luck.
I would definitely love to stay there if I could, if I had like a tent and a sleeping bag. You know, I feel like that's definitely somewhere where no one would bother you, really. And even if you saw other people, they'd probably be like the kind of people that don't want to be bothered either. So
we did, weirdly. There was people when me and Jameson were coming up. There was two people, and they had parked behind us because they had come from somewhere, and they're like, they come up to me, and they're like, what do we do? We've never been here. Is this correct? Is this right? Where do we go? And I was like, I don't know. I've never been here either. I was like, if you go down, there's water, and you can camp. There's a little camp. People camped there, so you can camp by the water if you want. And I guess there's also... I guess there's like 5 designated camp areas, but there's nothing there. There's not like, you know, a thing for water or electric or anything. It's just designated camp spots.
Yeah,
and
something.
You can camp anywhere you want outside of the designated camp spots.
Yeah, those are basically just slightly cleared out so you can have a tent there.
Yep, yeah, that's all they were. So that was pretty, that was kind of crazy, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, it was just interesting because it's a state forest and it's not all trails and, you know.
There was only one trail that I could see. And it wasn't a trail. It was like just like a slight path and then it basically goes down a cliff.
Yeah, and then you get to the bottom. You gotta kind of like jump out over into the water.
And it's not even that long of a path at all. It's like, it's just basically nothing.
And what else was crazy is the elevation when we were at the top in the forest, it was 81 degrees. And then we got to the bottom where the water was, it was 91 degrees and the water was very hot. So, yeah. And it was kind of gross, you know, hot creek water.
Which doesn't make any sense because it was moving pretty fast.
I mean, there wasn't a huge volume though. You could tell it was low. You know, you could tell it was low volume at that point. What were you singing?
Oh, sorry. It just makes me think of Les Claypool songs, which are often about, I like to go fishing. I like to go hunting. I like to go camping. And so I just often think of that type of thing with him.
Oh, yeah, they're all hot.
I don't know what you said, Dudley, but yeah, it's pretty cool. But that's the one, that's the song, The Rumble of the Diesel, where he's just talking about how he gets on his boat and he just goes fishing, which he films a fishing show. I always say this, but he was filming it recently in Lake Erie. He was filming it in the small boat harbor, and then he was also in, you know, he was in the Niagara River. He does it with the guy from Ween, who also likes fishing a lot. It was going to be on TV, but they couldn't really sell it, so they just put it on YouTube now, but I don't know.
Hmm.
You know, I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. That's why out of all, like, musical celebrities, I think I relate to Les Claypool the most. He just sort of seems like a standard kind of blue-collar kind of guy who just happened to get famous. He always says, you know, I used to hang out with a lot of tough guys in my dad's shop. Everybody in my family was a mechanic. So I just kind of picked that up. It's like, oh, I can relate. But, yeah, I don't know. Like even when you could tell, like, when he's on MTV back in the 90s and he's at spring break and stuff, you could tell he just does not want to be there and he just thinks everybody sucks.
I'll tell you what, it's the damn MTV.
Yeah, exactly. I love that episode of King of the Hill where Hank meets whatever the guy who plays the Fonz and
Henry Winkler,
and he's like, Hank's like, oh, I love fishing too, there, Henry, and then he's like, I do love to fish. It's about communing with nature, and you cast it out to feel the vibrations. He's like, I don't know what kind of fishing you're doing, but I don't think it's the same as mine there. And I don't know. I just think that's so hilarious. It's about where they go to, like, meet Peggy's mom, who is, like, a cattle farm owner. And I don't know, like, somehow they let all the cattle through, and they, like, destroy Henley Winkler's, like, section of river he owns or something. I don't know. I just love that one. I love that show. That's probably my favorite show. Or at least
Which
one
show?
Of them. King of the Hill. That show is just so good. I've watched that show like a zillion times and it never gets boring. It's so good. I mean, I don't know. I love that show. I love American Dad. I love Ren and Stimpy. I love that 70s show. Buffy, of course. Angel, of course.
It's always fun to rewatch Buffy, too. We're rewatching it right now. Definitely interesting.
Yeah, that's definitely true.
The person who played Jenny Callender in season 1 and 2, and she did make guest appearances later on, was the main, like, backup dancer for Prince.
Hi, baby.
And then also she would, like, represent him when he didn't want to do interviews. She would speak for him, so that was kind of crazy. But then now she's, like, uber super religious, and she is, like, horrified that she played a witch and was, you know, against Jesus or something, I guess, in her mind at least. So, yeah. Interesting.
It is interesting. I'd also like to say, One Piece is, like, one of my favorite things ever. It's not even just shows. It's just, like, one of my favorite things. And I think it's so lame they're gonna make a Netflix show out of it. I cannot imagine, like, actors playing One Piece characters. I know, like, nobody knows what I'm talking about, but it just seems so lame. Don't make One Piece onto, like, a Netflix show. I've been reading One Piece since I was in, like, the fourth grade when I saw it at Tops that one time. And I cannot imagine, like, Luffy just being some dude on screen. That makes no sense. That's so dumb. I don't know. Maybe it'll be good, but I don't want to watch it. Do not make One Piece a Netflix show. Why would you do that?
I mean, they already are, aren't they?
Yeah.
Okay.
I know Rocknuts likes it, but I don't know. I'm skeptical.
Fair enough.
I can't imagine just some dude just, like, I don't know. One Piece is just so crazy. It's like pirates with superpowers. Like, how can you even do that?
You can do whatever you want. If you have the means, I guess. You can get away with it. For better or for worse.
Yeah. Dang Netflix. Which took me forever to realize. I didn't understand it was Netflix. Like movies. Like internet flicks. And I was so... I remember I just told that to Andy. He's like, yeah. That's what I saw that.
What else would it be, Net? Net for internet. You didn't get that part?
The flick. You flick it.
I was, like, standing next to the locker, and Andy just looked at me. He's like, yeah, that's right.
Well, I'm
but
sorry.
Don't ruin One Piece, you know? One Piece is too good for that. One Piece is too cool. Come on. He's a pirate who's made out of rubber. That's funny.
I don't even know if I've really...
It's a pirate guy who like stretches and can beat people up, and he, like, it's like, imagine if Tom and Jerry was like superpowers. Like the creator always says, oh, I just wanted to make it like imagine like a pirate who had the powers of Tom and Jerry characters, and like he can just stretch and blow up his arm and beat people up.
Does it go this way? Is this the front?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I mean, that's, yeah. The Wano part's interesting. This is the first time I've ever actually caught up to where One Piece is. And, like, I've never read Wano until now, and it's fascinating because it's based on, like, old-timey Japan, which normally it's not. But, I don't know, like, every time they're on a different island, like, the previous island was Dressrosa, which is based on, like, medieval Spain. And before that, they were on Fishman Island, which is like, there's like mermaids, and then there's also like people that are like fish humans. I don't know, but they're not mermaids. They just like walk around. I don't know how to explain it. But don't ruin One Piece. That sucks. I've been reading One Piece for like literally 20 years. It's like the highest selling comic by a single author of all time. And the only comics
I did not know that.
The only comics it's behind in general are Superman and Batman, which have been running since the 30s, and they're by like a zillion different authors.
So it is the longest running one by one author, then, I'm guessing?
It is the highest selling comic by a single author, and it's been running. The guy's been making it since 95.
Nice.
And it's still ongoing. I love One Piece. Don't ruin it. The only place that's not really high selling in is the U.S. It's really high selling in Europe and Asia and stuff, but it never really sold that well in the U.S., but I always liked it. Like I said, I always tell that story, but I've never just seen it at Tops. I was in the fourth grade, and I was like, dude, this is so cool. Like, why can he, like, blow up his arm and punch people like a cartoon? And it's just so funny. I don't know. Nobody knows
because
what I'm talking about, but I love One Piece. And it, like, all the, his Wait. Enemy pirates were like, what?
You were asked a question.
Oh, what's that?
Is it because he is a cartoon?
Yeah, pretty much. That's definitely why. Like, I hate comics that take things so seriously. Like, this is at least funny. I mean, yeah, One Piece is just like, it's like my favorite, like, thing. I've loved One Piece so long. The only other person I know who, like, I don't know anybody else that ever really even, like, liked it or knew what it was other than Jong, and he's pretty much the only one, because it's just never really talked off in America. I'm going to see the movie tomorrow. They only show it. They showed it once last week, and they're showing it again tomorrow. But I'm excited to see it. I've seen all the One Piece movies. They usually only show them, like, once or twice. But because nobody cares about them in America, but I like them.
I had a student that really liked One Piece.
It's so good. I was still surprised Rocky.
Sadly,
liked
they didn't continue, and that made me sad because they're real cool.
I think the best powers are Robin, who can like she has like a zillion arms, and she can like sprout as many arms and legs as she wants. That sounds like a good power.
Sounds like an alright power. I mean, I guess and she has to be a good multitasker, though, or it's kind of useless. She's going to spaz out and whack herself in the face or something.
Well, she can also make giant versions of her own arm.
Oh.
To, like, smack people.
That's kind of fun.
What's the other good power? Let's see. I mean, Chopper's power is kind of stupid. He's just a reindeer that can talk. I don't know. His power's not that cool. Yeah, I don't know. I just think it's cool. I guess it's funny that he has, like, reindeer thumbs. One of my favorite things ever was that I was able to bond over, like, the Molise about One Piece because, like, they also grew up with it. And so, we drew all the characters from One Piece in my notebook. That was really cool. It's, like, I've always wanted to send a letter to the creator that, like, it sort of bonded people from different cultures because they don't really speak English, but they know that I like One Piece. So, they could just say the character name. I'd be like, ah, yes, Sanji. And they're like, ah, Sanji's our favorite character. Because Sanji, of course, is a chef, and I think they all like that he... Yes, they are indeed chefs. The Molise are all chefs, so they relate to the character. The interesting thing is, Rinko, she specializes more in Western cooking, but, you've got Paro, who's from Osaka. He can also do Western cooking, but he specifies in particularly Osakan cooking, which is a little different than other Japanese cooking. It's really, really good. I love Osakan food. And then, Paro is if you follow their Instagrams, they still love making food. They're really, really good. Yuzuru, he's a really good chef. He's more of a, he's really good at just different, he does a lot of soups and stuff. They're all really good in, like, specific regions of food types. I really think that they're excellent chefs.
Are they still trying to get back here?
Yeah, they really want to become citizens, so if anybody can help them when they come back, I'm sure they can need it.
So let me just say this. I just found something out very interesting about the Craig Colony for Epileptics that we visited. The Olmsted brothers, which I'm not sure, there was John Charles Olmsted and Frederick Law Olmsted, designed it.
Wow.
Isn't that crazy?
Olmsted? So yeah. That's kind of why it looks like a park then.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's fascinating.
It is fascinating. I hope they do something with it. Don't let it just rot.
Yeah, bring it back.
That'd be cool. Especially since it won't.